Welcome to part one of module two. In this part, we are focused on what are the different types of assessments that can be used to monitor student progress within a DBI framework. And remember, this entire course is focused on mathematics, so we're going to think about mathematics assessments. So our objectives for this module, we are going to think about the definition of formative assessments and the difference between a general outcome measure and a single skill measure. Then we'll think about the definition of a diagnostic, and then finally we will sum up with the definition of a summative assessment. All right, so where are we? In this module, we have been talking about our DBI framework. And specifically in this part, we are focusing on the progress monitoring. So how do we know that the intervention that we have in place is working? We progress monitor students. But the progress monitoring doesn't only take place here. If you have to make an adaptation to the intervention, progress monitoring also occurs here. And then also in this module, we'll briefly talk about diagnostics. So we're going to be talking about all of these green components in this first part of module two. So let's go ahead and get started. Let's think about formative assessment. So formative assessment is when we gather data during learning. And this helps make judgment for learning. So whether a student is benefiting from the instructional program or whether a student is not benefiting from the instructional program. And you may be familiar with the term progress monitoring right here. And progress monitoring is just one type of formative assessment, but it's the type of formative assessment that we are going to use to determine whether students are responding or not responding when we have a really good instructional platform or really good instructional adaptations in place. Now, when we think about formative assessments, there's really two types of formative assessments that fall under this kind of umbrella term of progress monitoring measures. First, we have general outcome measures. And that may seem like a fancy name, but I want you to just think about general outcome measures as measures that are general to the student's math knowledge. So they may have a lot of different types of problems on there, and they're kind of like, what are the general outcomes that a student needs to know by the end of grade two or by the end of grade five? So they assess the grade level mathematics curriculum. It's going to be a mix of mathematics problems. And you may also be familiar with this term right here, CBM. CBM is just one type of general outcome measure. And we're going to come back and talk a little bit about those in just a few slides. But progress monitoring measures may also be single skill measures. And a single skill measure measures, guess what? A single skill. So for example, the student might do all problems related to division or all problems related to addition of fractions. It measures a single skill. Now let's look at examples of a general outcome measure and a single skill measure. So here's an example of a general outcome measure. So if I look at this first problem asks how many circles are there in all? And so here the student has to add the different circles. Here, how many shares is this rectangle divided into? So this is kind of a fractions or a division type question. In this question, the student has to compare different numbers. In this question, the student has to measure this looks like a stick or something like that. In this question, the student has to solve a word problem. And in this question, the student has to take digital time and relate it to analog time. So when we think about this, this is a general outcome measure because there's lots of different types of mathematics problems. And this would be a really good measure to use as a progress monitoring measure so that I can see how a student does from one week to the next across the school year on all of the things that a student would be expected to know by the end of that year. Now I want to show you a single skill measure. So here's a single skill measure. This is what it looks like. And guess what this is measuring? It's only measuring students' single-digit addition knowledge. So it's a single skill measure. It doesn't have a mix of problems. Now, when we think about progress monitoring, it's better to use a general outcome measure so that we understand how a student performs across the school year. And it's not as great to use a single skill measure because that usually only measures kind of a small time period for what a student is working on in mathematics. Now, with our formative assessments, remember we're gathering data during learning, and that's occurring in our DBI framework right here and right there. And as we gather that data, then we are going to graph that student's data to understand what is the trend in the student's data. Is this student benefiting from this instruction? Are we going to continue doing this instructional platform? Or does this student need an instructional change? Now, with these formative assessments that we've been talking about, with the progress monitoring here and there, general outcome measures really are a better type of progress monitoring. So I'd really press you to think about using a general outcome measure rather than a single skill measure. And why are they good? As I've already said, they show what a student is supposed to learn across the school year, not just in a single time period during the school year. So a general outcome measure, if we graph those scores, it would look like this. A single skill measure might also look like this. But the problem is, once the student starts to learn something different in math, this single skill measure is not actually going to help us understand the student's growth across the entire school year of mathematics learning. So that's why we want to use a general outcome measure instead of one of these single skill measures. So I want you to think about these formative assessments as the cornerstone to the DBI process. So even though they aren't listed first, you will see that they occur in tandem with our intervention program. You cannot do good intensive intervention without progress monitoring students, because we always want to know if things are working or if things are not working. And this progress monitoring helps us make decisions on a timely basis. So for example, if I've got this graph for Maria here, I see that across these 8 weeks, her growth is pretty stagnant. She's not making the growth that we would want her to make in the intensive intervention process. So we need to make a decision about Maria's response right here. We don't want to delay that any longer because Maria needs our help. The problem is, if we don't look at the data and we don't make timely decisions, we might get to this situation here. You can see that I've done instruction for 16 weeks and I haven't made any instructional changes, and so I am not helping Maria. In fact, I'm letting her flounder, and that's not fair to her. So these formative assessments help us make decisions about Maria and make informed decisions on a timely basis. So in sum, our formative assessments, when we're thinking about these, which is our part right here and our part right there, we should use general outcome measures, and then we take that data and then we determine whether students are showing response or non-response, and then we make decisions about adaptations for those non-responsive students on a timely basis. Now, I want you to look at workbook activity number one, and you're going to look at different examples of formative assessments. And I want you to determine whether each is an example of a general outcome measure or a single skill measure. Have fun. So we just talked about formative assessments. Now let's talk about diagnostic assessments. And that brings us to this part on the DBI diagram. In a diagnostic assessment, this helps us think about data that's gathered either before we begin instruction or during instruction. And a diagnostic really helps us understand students' strengths and weaknesses. So let's say we've got our student Maria, and later on we'll talk about how to make decisions about Maria's data here. But we understand that after 8 weeks of instruction, that this our instructional program really isn't benefiting Maria in the way that it should. And so we are going to make a decision to make an instructional change. And this right here is where the diagnostic comes into play. So we conduct a diagnostic to understand which adaptations need to be made to Maria's instructional program. So remember, we're right here within our DBI framework. Now there are lots of different diagnostic assessments out there, but a good diagnostic will measure multiple areas of mathematics. A good diagnostic is reliable and valid. And a good diagnostic is going to provide a detailed score profile. So it's not just going to give you one score for Maria, but it's going to give you multiple scores. So it's going to tell you how Maria does with addition, how Maria does with subtraction, how Maria does with place value, how Maria does with geometry. So it's really going to do a deep dive into Maria's math skills and give you detailed information about those skills. So some of the diagnostics that are out there include the Test of Early Mathematics Ability. This is often called the TEMA. That's a good diagnostic if you're working with students anywhere from usually 3 to 8 years old. Also for that range of students, we have the Early Math Diagnostic Assessment. For students across grades K through 12, the Key Math is a classic diagnostic. We use that in a lot of our research studies. It's a really good diagnostic to use. And there's also the Test of Mathematical Abilities, and you'll probably have some diagnostics in your school. You just need to figure out where they are and how you can use them. So in sum, a good diagnostic should be comprehensive. So for example, it should test across different domains of mathematics. A good diagnostic should help us identify students' strengths and weaknesses. And a good diagnostic is going to help inform those adaptations. So before you make adaptations, we want to conduct a diagnostic so that we understand which adaptations to make. Because remember, one of the big intensive intervention is we can't waste students' time. So we don't want to just make some guesses as to which adaptations are going to be helpful. We're going to use diagnostic information to help inform and make really smart adaptation choices for the student who we're working with. So now it's time to do workbook activity number 2. I want you to look at this sample diagnostic score report and identify what are the student's strengths and what are the student's weaknesses. Finally, we get to summative assessment. And it's really not a part of the DBI framework, but I do want to talk about it because it's a third type of assessment data that you might gather. And you're probably always thinking about summative assessments when you're designing and delivering intensive intervention. So a summative assessment includes data that's gathered after learning. Often these are those high-stakes assessments that are given at the end of the school year across most schools in the United States. And as I said, a summative assessment really isn't part of DBI, but because most of our students, if not all of them, will take summative assessments, we have to keep summative assessments in mind. So what does the student need to know in terms of mathematics, and how is the student going to demonstrate their mathematics competency? Now, if you do have some summative assessments that are given across the school year, perhaps fall, winter, and spring, if they are quick assessments, you can use some of that information as diagnostics, but most often summative assessments don't give us the score reports quickly, and so if it's going to be a delay of a few months before you get those scores, you really can't rely on that summative assessment to use within your DBI framework. So now look at workbook activity number 3. In this, I want you to conduct a survey of the assessments that are available within your school. And you're going to fill in the table with your current formative assessments that are available, the diagnostic assessments that are available, and the summative assessments that are available. And then based on that survey of the assessments, you're going to fill in your assessment needs so that you have to figure out which assessments you're going to need to do DBI well. All right, so just a few considerations about everything we've talked about in this module. Within our DBI framework, we utilize both formative assessment here and here, and then we'll use a diagnostic assessment right here when we have to make adaptations to the student's instructional program. You can't do DBI without progress monitoring. So in fact, if I cover those up, our DBI framework totally falls apart. So I really want you to think about the role of both of these progress monitoring measures because we can't do DBI without them. And then this diagnostic, we don't really want to do DBI without that because it really helps inform good instructional adaptations. So I'll go ahead and make those go away, but I want you to remember that we can't do DBI without those. So let's review our checklist for this module. In this module, lots of different language. We were focused on the different types of assessments used to monitor student progress. So we talked about how we can use formative assessments to make ongoing decisions about whether a student is responsive or non-responsive to the instruction that we're providing. We talked about using diagnostic assessments to understand student strengths and weaknesses, and this is going to help us make good adaptations to the student's instructional program. And then finally, we briefly talked about summative assessments that might be used to gauge end-of-year learning.